Hi, I'm Jackie Bernard, Programs Assistant at Uncodon's Cabin Historic Site, the home of Josiah Hansen. And I am so excited to share with you a series of videos we film called Discovering Dawn. The short videos are a look at the contributions that African Canadians have made to the development of my hometown, Dresden, Ontario. The town was a final destination for hundreds of refugees from American slavery. We had the pleasure of working with local historian Marie Carter.
So Jackie, here we are on the corner of Lindsley and Metcalf Street in Dresden. And you probably walked down the street 100 times, walked past this house many times. And it seems like a very ordinary house, doesn't it?
It does, yes.
And until I looked at this house with a conservancy person, pointed out to me that it was a Regency-style cottage, and that really set off an interesting investigation into this property. Regency style is a style before Victorian, so it's quite old. It's from about 1850, and that's a very important time in Dresden history, because in about 1853, when the Fugitive Slave Act was in 1850, when the Fugitive Slave Act was passed in the United States, a number of Pennsylvania freemen and other freemen from Ohio and other parts of the United States, northern United States, found it really difficult to do their work there. They could not really make a living very well. There was rising violence at the time against successful black businessmen. And also the Underground Railroad work that a lot of them were doing put them at great peril. So quite a large number of them came north across the border. And interesting, in 1853, a number of them came to Dresden. And one of the people that we've been able to associate with this house has been William Whipper. And we think William Whipper may have been the builder. And if you can imagine this house at that time, it would have had this lovely gingerbreading along the eaves. And it would have been in this Regency cottage style. The layout of this house today still has the original rooms in it. It still has the morning room and the little pantry in the back and all these kinds of features. And the most interesting part that dates it is if you go into the basement of this house and you look at the beams, you'll see that the striation marks on the beams from the cut marks are straight up and down rather than circular, which helps to date it to that 1850 period. So anyhow, we know it's an old house. Whipper owned it about in that 1850 period until about 1883. It's one of the last properties that he sold here, or that his widow sold after he died. And it's very strategically located. It's next to what used to be one of the main town docks in the area. You see the gradual slope towards the river.
Yeah.
This is actually where a dock once existed. There would have been a stockyard just up this way. Whipper's Inn was in this lot right across the street, and there were a number of people associated with the Whipper family who were also here. So we have Frances Moss Turner, who is married to Whipper's niece, is living in the house next door. We have Mary Smith, the grocer, who had the property Kitty Corner here. And Josiah Henson actually owned a property on this street as well. So you see that we have sort of a black community that is situated here on what at that time was more truly the main street of the town than St. George's today. So we have these business people who are here. And what business people they were. Jackie, you can't imagine. This is not the story we normally get about black history in the 19th century. But there were, in Pennsylvania, because of the advantages there of education, and actually there was a vote in Pennsylvania for black people at one point. So they were politically involved, and they were also very educated people, and sometimes very well-traveled people, and very literate. And William Whipper is a really prime example of this. He and his partner, Stephen Smith, were the richest black men in America of their day. They owned coal yards, lumber yards, stock in the Reading and Pennsylvania Railroad, and rolling stock on the railroad, because in those days you bought the train cars to move your goods on and ran them on the railroad and rented time on the rails. And so here he was set up with this transportation and industry. And when he came to Dresden to escape all this that was happening in the States, he began to transfer his wealth here with the aim of eventually moving here. Now, we don't think he actually moved here, but his wife and his family did spend some time here, especially during the Civil War. But for Whipper, when he arrived, and the other Pennsylvania freemen that were associated with him, including the Purnells, the Shads, and a number of other people, when they came here, they began to take the money that they had previously invested in the United States, and they brought it and invested here. So Whipper built a flour mill, he built a warehouse, a white pine lumber mill. And so you see where he begins to create infrastructure here in this community that would help support the people that he had sent north. Because the really remarkable thing about Whipper is he's a conductor on the Underground Railroad. So some of those train cars had false ends in them, and he was smuggling people up with his lumber shipments. He also had a ship on the Great Lakes, and there was a marine link of the Underground Railroad, which we think may have been connected to the Centennial. Isn't that exciting?
Very exciting.
Yes, so here we have black abolitionists of the caliber of Whipper in this community, investing in residential properties, stores, and all these industries to build up the community. And this not only benefits the black citizens that are here, who quite often Whipper had sent here from the States, but also the white community as well. Because Whipper is very much a person who believes in integration, equal opportunity, and of lifting up the whole of society in order to make life better for black people as well. And so what we have then is Whipper loaning money to white people as well as black people. And in some cases you will see where some of the later white industrialists in Dresden got their start because Whipper loaned them money or held a mortgage for them earlier on.
Thank God for somebody like him.
Yes, it was very much needed at that time because there were no banks in the way that we think of them now. And so these private lenders were very important people. So and Whipper's philosophy too, and his kind of whole approach of integration, of racial cooperation, I think is a wonderful inspiration for us. And it's just really a shame that the influence of Whipper was so, and his colleagues was so short-lived. And we really only have this very brief period between 1851 and 1861 where they're present in the community in any great numbers. And Whipper himself was said to have wanted to move here, but that when the Civil War broke out, he wanted to be back home and do what he could there, particularly during that Reconstruction period, to try to gain rights for black people in America. So we lost him, unfortunately, but the legacy of Whipper, Purnells, all the rest of them, really is important to Dresden's history, and I think tells us a really important aspect of black history that really needs more attention,
yes.
I think, of how they were community builders, they were founding fathers of our town, really, and theaters of the early industry in the community, so it's a tremendous legacy.
It is.